I want to present today the topic about building gRPC services with .NET Core. Probably many of you know about this technology, but for me and for lots of people I know, this is pretty new, and I decided to present this today. So as you know, today is a trend to build microservices. So what it is? Microservices could be built in different languages and in different functions for different purposes. So let's see in this example. Here we have a user, and user, for example, talk to buy service, and this service need to talk to the store or something like that. If user wanted to buy something, he need to pay for it, and he talk to payment service, and payment service need to talk to bank. And so, and again, one user made his purchase, he need to deliver it this, and he talk to delivery service, and this service need to talk to delivery providers, and so on. But this is a pretty simple solution, and we can have more complex, for example, like we see this. Here we have a lot of microservices, and these microservices talk to one to another, and this is very complicated. And they need to agree on many things, how to communicate to each other. So as I said, microservices could be built on different languages and encompass different functions of the business. And they need to agree on a lot of things. For example, the microservices must exchange information and need to agree on the API, how to exchange data, the data format, the error patterns, load balancing, and so on. And one of the most important is API. So the popular choice for API is REST, GraphQL, and so. And today I want to show you another way of the API calling gRPC. Let's talk a bit of the history of the APIs. We have this picture, and maybe the date on this picture is not very precise, but they demonstrate very well the main time periods of API evolution. So in 1991, we got method, the common object request broker architecture, named CORBA. It's the first line, and maybe it's the first something like RPC, but it's not RPC, and we think about it today. A bit later, we get RDI. RDI, it's remote data access. So we can think about it like we can query data from the database over the network interface. And later, in 1998, we got a formal specification for RPC released by Microsoft, and it was based on XML. So finally, we had a strict contract to how to build different system. And 1 year later, we also have released SOAP from Microsoft, and it's also much very RPC based. In 2000, the ages of REST and REST evolutions, RESTful services as HTTP API. And later it was evolution of REST, and later we get OData. It's also built over the REST, and later in 2015, we got GraphQL, and 2016 formal specification for gRPC. So a part of these, a part of just technology, the approaches and paradigm also in the industry also changed. In mostly in 2000, we had like customer specific APIs. It means one API and one client or limited number of clients. In 2010, we started to have more and more API clients, and the requirements for API has changed. So the API from this point have to be more flexible to satisfy more and more client needs. And we can group this API by the what they do in next group. For example, queries API. When we want to empower our clients to retrieve the data and that they want favoring flexibility. Flat file APIs is just API when we send to the client some flat file like a CSV, XML or JSON. Streaming APIs, it's a real-time API. They should be very rapid. In most cases used bidirectional communication across the wire. RPC APIs, it's when one component calling another component across a distributed network. And web API is probably most popular. HTTP APIs, REST services, what we use in almost every applications. So if you ask what is the best way of the API, and the answer should be there is no single best API style. So there is always a best API style for the particular problem. That's the key point. Every API can have a lot of restrictions. And on this slide, we have a quote from Phil Sturgeon, which is very famous man in building API, and he built a lot of APIs and created his own book named Build APIs You Won't Hit. And he said, if an API is mostly actions, maybe it should be RPC. And if API is mostly CRUD, it should manipulating is manipulating related data, maybe it should be REST. So I agree with his point, and let's move on. Let's see what is key point on the building API. Building API, maybe it's not very easy, and we need to think about a lot of things. So for example, we need to think about the data model, what we will use. It will be JSON, XML, or binary format. We need to think about endpoints. It should be single endpoint for everything like we have for GraphQL, for example, and it should be different URLs for GET POST like we have in HTTP APIs. We need to think about versioning and so on. Also, how we will handle errors or errors on API, errors on client, and need to think about efficiency, latency. What we should do if we have a lot of programming languages and different services are written on different languages and so on. And this is very complicated stuff to build APIs. So, and we want to have API that we left everything to the framework, and we can only concentrate on the business purposes. And gRPC allows us to left a lot of problem behind. But remember, there is no silver bullet, it's just one of the purpose how to build API. So what is gRPC? gRPC is a modern and open source high performance RPC framework that can run in any environment. It can efficiently connect services across data centers with pluggable support, load balancing, tracing, health checking, and authentication. It is also very good fit to build mobile applications and browser for browsers and backend services. gRPC was originally built in Google, and the first version of gRPC in the Google was called Stubby. And it was a solution in Google for almost a decade, and it connects a lot of microservices running in Google, and it was very it showed good, very good performance, and it is like backbone for every services in Google. So in 2015 they decided to build next version of Stubby and call it gRPC and made it open sourced. So the main scenarios for using gRPC is efficiently connecting a lot of microservices in microservices style architecture. It can connect mobile devices, browser clients, and backend services, and it put generating efficient client libraries. At the core of gRPC API is a contract, and at the high level, it allows you to define request and response, and everything else will be handled of this framework for you. It will build client and service, and you need to just implement your business functions. So it is also platform independent, show good performance, low latency, and it is very easy to plug in authentication, for example, to it and logging and monitoring. In a few words, what is gRPC? gRPC is using HTTP2 on the transport level for the transmission data, and protobuf language. It's interface definition language plus data format. We will talk what is protobuf later. So how can we get started to build gRPC service? At the core of gRPC, you just need to define the messages and services using protocol buffers. And the rest of gRPC code will be generated for you, and you'll have to do only implementation of it. gRPC solves a lot of problems and generates ton of codes, but we shouldn't care about it because this is done by a compilator for every programming language, and we don't need to care about it. So one protofile will work for over 12 programming languages and allow to use framework that scales to millions of RPC per second. So let's talk about this protocol buffer. As I said, protocol buffer or protobuf is interface definition language. It describes once and generates interfaces for any languages. It describes service model. And service model and service structure of the request and response. And it uses binary format for network transmission data. And here we have a little example of it. So what we see here? We see the message search request, and we see the message search response. Search response have result, and this result could be repeated. It means that we can have zero or more than one result. And we have service definition, method find, we set accept search request and return search response. And that's it. Nothing else we have in protofile. And protobuf compiler will generate for us client and service, and we will just use it in our application. So what is advantages and disadvantages of using protocol buffer? Protocol buffer buffers are language agnostic. So we can build our protobuf file and generate code for different languages. So the data is fully typed in protocol buffer. So data is also compressing automatically. So we can, for this, less CPU is used. Documentation can be embedded in this schema. Data in protocol buffer is smaller and faster than XML and JSON. And it's very important because it's saving network bandwidth. And also code is generated automatically, as I said, for many popular programming languages. And what is the disadvantages? As disadvantages, I see that support for some specific languages might be lacking. And it is difficult to open and read or debug the data because it's binary and compressed and you need to use some specific tool for it. Let's move on. Here we have JSON vs protobuf serialization comparison. And what we see on this diagram, we see that almost in all cases, protocol buffer is less than JSON. When we have, for example, JSON in 100 bytes, the same size of protobuf will be in more than half time less. And the same for zipped protobuf and zipped JSON. Even we see that compressing protobuf is not an option because compressed and not compressed protobuf is almost the same for all the sizes. Let's just a bit compare gRPC vs HTTP API or REST services. It's a general concept. I don't want to say something is bad or something is worse in this. First of all, gRPC, it's contract first approach. So we define our service and our messages in protofile. But HTTP API is content first. We defined what content we want to get from the API. This could be JSON or also what URL we will have, like we have, for example, product number 5, give me product with this number. And we will get, for example, JSON with product data. In gRPC, contracts are designed for human. And in API, content is designed for human. gRPC use binary serialization and REST, for example, use text serialization. gRPC hides all remoting complexity, so we can have only one endpoint, and that's it. In HTTP API, we have different endpoints for different method and for different data. Here we have a list with supported languages and platform for gRPC. So we can see how most popular languages like C Sharp, Java, Node, Python, and so on. Let's talk a bit about four types of API in gRPC. So gRPC supports four types of API. First of all, it's unary API. So a client just says, give me something, and server, here it is. Very simple. And this is how almost every API work. We also have streaming support. And streaming support, streaming capability is enabled through HTTP2. So for example, we have server streaming, where a client says to server, give me something, and server respond, here is one, here is two, here is three, and so on. And the same, we have client streaming when client sends to the server a few messages and server respond only once. And we also have bidirectional streaming when we have a set of messages from the client and set of messages from the server, and it is more complicated and it is hardest to understand, but it could be useful in some, for example, chatting scenarios where we build some chat, for example. And here we see how it is defined in gRPC. These four types of API. So when we have a unary API, we just define the method, the request, and the response. When we have service streaming method, we define the method name, we define the request, and we define the response with stream. So the server could send a lot of such responses. And the same for client streaming, when client send to the server a lot of requests. And bidirectional streaming, when client sent a lot of requests and a server sent a lot of response. Very quick about gRPC web. So in short, we cannot use pure gRPC in the browser because there is no good support on the client JavaScript and something like that level for browsers, and not all of the browsers support HTTP2. So we have to use some proxy services for this. So it could be one of the disadvantage of gRPC is that it have limited support of web programming. So, and on the last slide, we have pros and cons of gRPC. So from the advantages, I would say the advantages of gRPC are that the gRPC is language independent and it builds contracts first. It fast demonstrate high performance, used HTTP2 for multiplexing, support streaming, auto-generate code for many popular languages, use binary serialization, and we don't need more versioning because we have just single endpoint. And we talk to this endpoint and do not care about versions. From the disadvantages, I would say that not all of the browsers and servers have full support of HTTP2. gRPC web provides limited support for calling gRPC services, and additional tools needs to check the binary data. It is also difficult, almost impossible using this all gRPC performance in legacy applications. And some of the support for some rare or specific languages could be lacking. So here it is. And I want to show a demo project where I use the gRPC. So here in the solution we have payment gateway. It's in this gateway we will implement gRPC service that will accept some for example payment transactions, and will just and it will just save them to database. And we have two clients: it's console client and worker client. It's .NET Core 3 projects. And we have like one simple common lib where I connect this gRPC service as a service reference to the service that is implemented in payment gateway. So for example, let's see to the our protofile. We see this protofile. So we first of all define here what versions of syntax we will use. We use proto 3. Sometime ago we had proto 2, but proto 3 is a newer version, so we will use proto 3. We also define as optional C# namespace. It means protocol buffer compiler will generate classes for us. They all will be in this namespace. We import some languages, some libraries. This is libraries defined by Google, and we define our service. So what our service will do? It will emulate payment gateways that accept payment request and return payment response. Let's see what is payment request and payment response. So payment request have some data about merchant. It just for emulation payment transactions, it's far away from real payment transaction. So payment request have merchant, have transaction type, have amount of the data, have currency type and source. In source, we will put the information about who is calling this service. Transaction type could be invalid, payment on refund, and currency type also could be USD, Canadian dollar, and euro, and so on. In the response, we will have message. We will have response status. We will have receiving time and this transaction ID. Remember that when we receive this transaction, we is going to save this to DB and receive this transaction ID. And response status could be failed or successful. We also have another method for streaming. It is a client streaming when we don't know how many transactions a client is going to send to us. It's just for demonstration purposes. It's maybe not very good in this case to build streaming, but I want to demonstrate it, so I build such method. And also we have a method to build to get transaction in, where we pass just transaction request and transaction response. And what we have? In transaction request, we have just transaction ID by what we will return this transaction response. And in transaction response, we have transaction ID, the same as in transaction request. We have transaction status that could be one from this enum and transaction amount. It is very similar how we can define our messages in C# as well. So we need to add to the project next package calling gRPC as .NET Core, and inside we have gRPC tools, and the gRPC tools will build for us our classes in our applications. We do not need to care about these classes, but in our implementation, we just need to inherit from them. For example, we have our payment service. We inherit from payment gateway service, payment gateway service base. This class is automatically generated by this compiler. And it also have our method that is defined in payment protofile. Here we have three methods. So we have this method in our payment service. We just need to override them and implement the services, the logic. So I want to explain what is going on in this method just very shortly. When we receive the request, I just validate this request. And let's see to this method. When we get this request, we validate and we can throw RPC exception. And this exception could be passed to the client, and client can see what's going on and why this request wasn't successful. We just implement this method for create payment. Let's see the method for streaming. In this case, we just saw a simple case and unary API method when we receive one request. We have here context with some additional info, but we don't need it now. When we have here one request and we have one response, very simple. But when we have streaming, it is client streaming, so we are going to have a lot of messages from the client and only one response. So the message, the parameter here is async stream reader with the message that we can get, its payment request. And what we do here, we build our response. Remember that we will have only one response, but a lot of requests. So in the response, we will just return the count, how many transactions was successful, how failed, and so on. And how we will read all these streaming requests from the client. We have a nice feature of C# 8. It's named await for each, and we read every message from the stream and works with it as with a single message, and to the response just put the count, and if something was bad, we increase the failed count, and that's it. And when we finish streaming from the client, we will get this response, how many transactions was successful and how many transactions was failed. So, and also we have just a simple method for get info about transaction. So we have just request. We receive these transactions from our database or some repository, build this response and send it to the client. So let's see now to the client. We have two clients, console and worker client. Let's see to the console. What we have here. First of all, I want to show you how to build gRPC client. So I wanted to emulate here a bit service provider pattern, but it's a bit difficult to do in console. But anyway, we need to build gRPC client. For this purpose, we create a channel. To the channel, we pass the address where our gRPC service is running. And by default, the service is, I put the service URL to the config file. Let's see it. By default, it runs on the local host 5001, this service URL. And we need to build this channel with this service URL, and we could pass here an additional channel options. I pass Logger Factory, and if we pass this Logger Factory, it means when we run and something was bad on the server, we will see our exceptions in our console or how our logger is configured on the client. And we just build this client in the next line. Just create a new client and pass the channel as an argument. So now in the main method, I created a simple factory that will generate for us random transactions. We do not have time to look to it, but this will generate for us like random transactions in random data. We have our gRPC client, and we just calling it passing payment request. And we passing this payment request, we put, then we show it in the console, that again, we build transaction request. We want to get the info about these transactions that we just created. And we get this transaction response, and we also show in the console. Let's run it and see how it works. But first of all, I need to run our gRPC service by this command. By the way, I run this gRPC service in their local Kestrel server. I know now IIS Express also support HTTP2, but it will be easier to show the logs here. So our service is up now, and it is enabled on this host. Now let's run our client. Is building. So we see here that transaction was sent, everything successful. We have this receiving tab of these transactions, transaction ID, it's one. And the second, we get these transactions also from the service. We have all this info. We see the transactions is not processed. And let's see if the transactions was successfully added to database. So we see here the transactions. We see here the source that was called from console gRPC client. So let's now look to the worker client. I make it as a startup project. In worker client, it's just like a background service and it will run every 5 seconds. And here I implemented streaming. That means that we will send more than one message to the gRPC servers. So here I generate just random count. It will be between 2 and 5. And how we do streaming? First of all, we need to get the stream from the gRPC client. We will do it in this line. Just gRPC client get payment stream. This is the same name as we had in protofile. We get just get payment stream. Okay. And that here we generate some random transactions and write them to the stream. We don't know how many transactions it could be. So we send these transactions to the client, to the server. And after all, we complete sending request and just call the complete async method on the request stream. And we can get overall response of all transactions and show them in the console or in the log, how the log is implemented. So let's run it. By the way, in the console of our service, we also see the info that some transactions were saved to DB and so on. So what we see here, we see that worker completed sending transactions, transactions count was 3 and successful transactions always 3. And in 5 seconds, we also send 4 transactions and successful transactions also 4. And it will work every 5 seconds to send a random number of transactions. Let's see in the database. In the database, we see more transactions now. It will send from worker process. We see the source and the number is increasing. So let's stop our worker. we also see some info is logged here in the service console. So basically, this is what I wanted to show you today. And I'm ready to answer the question if you have any.
Hi, I have a question. What if our service is down? And do we receive some specific error message when trying to establish channel with service?
Yeah, of course, you receive the error. I do not remember which error exactly, but you need to control this on your client. The client is available or no.
Service is
available. Yeah, is the service available, sorry.
Yeah, I just, actually I received something like transient error and it's it doesn't seem that it's obviously error from service, but it looks like it could it be error that service is down when I receive transient error or something like that when trying to establish a connection with my service?
Actually, I didn't have this situation, so I don't know what this exact error, but you should get some error, yeah.
No, okay, it was just the first question. If you know the answer, thank you, I will investigate, thanks.